to see you all this morning, and I think this is a great time to thank our staff team, our worship team, all our children's workers, the cafe. Aren't they doing a fantastic job, friends? Aren't they? Let's give them a round of applause, yes. This time of year is crazy for everyone, and it's wonderful to see everyone working together as a church. So my name's Catherine, and we've been coming to Warnborough for about 10 years. My husband Lloyd, you've met speaking a few times, I know, and we've got two daughters, Abby and Mia. And in my day job, I'm usually working for a mission called Operation Mobilisation, affectionately known as OM, although the initials have stood for Operation Marriage occasionally. I met Lloyd in Siberia, which is halfway between England and Australia, right? So one of the amazing opportunities I had when I was working with OM was to be in Albania, which was a country that was completely closed to the gospel. And for 45 years, there was no chance for the gospel to be spoken in any way, shape, or form. And Brother Andrew called us one day in June 1991, and he said, "We've heard the government's falling. Would you like to join us on the first open outreach?" And we said, "Let's think about that. That sounds wonderful." And so we traveled down to Albania, and this country of 3 million people, literally no known believers, and people gathered around us, as you can see, in the parks, everywhere, asking the whole time, "Is there a God? Do you know God? Does God love Albania?" And at the end of the week, we got to baptize the first believers in the modern church in Albania. 47 men and women were baptized. So exciting. It was the most amazing time. But a year later, I went back to Albania, and the small church had formed, just a fellowship of people meeting together in a community hall. And as they were gathering, there were about 20 or 30 Albanians, new believers there. There was an old English lady sat at the back, and she was sobbing, and she was sobbing so much she couldn't actually speak. And Pranesh, who was leading the service at the time, he just said, "Ma'am, would you like to come forward? We'd like to pray for you," because she was clearly so moved by whatever and just sobbing. And so she slowly made her way forward. She was 81, and she stood at the front just weeping. And she said, "My husband and I, every night for 25 years, we knelt before we went to bed and we prayed for Albania. And we prayed that God would open this country and that the gospel would be able to be freely proclaimed in this country." And she said, "I got to see the answer to my prayers. Here I am in this country and the gospel is openly proclaimed. My husband went to be with the Lord before this happened, but I got to see the answer to my prayers." And ever since I heard that, which is a long time ago now, it has stayed with me. What am I longing for? What am I waiting for? What am I waiting for to happen? And I think waiting is a theme that resonates with us all, isn't it, friends? Waiting. We're often waiting on different things. On the 28th of November, a friend of mine living in Austria sent me a text of her Advent calendar. This is the 28th of November. All the doors were open, and the title said, "Oops, what am I going to tell the kids?" Waiting was too hard for her in that circumstance, clearly. My mother in the UK, she's undergoing chemotherapy. She's been waiting for good news, waiting to hear that the chemotherapy is working. Maybe you're waiting. Maybe you're waiting about news about a job, about a transfer, about health. Here at Warnborough, we're waiting, aren't we? We're waiting to know who will be our next senior pastor. And our friends in the Ukraine, who've inspired us so much this year, hey? They're waiting. They're waiting for peace in their nation. They're waiting for God to do a miracle and give them back their country in peace. And so many of us are waiting. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was an amazing German pastor who was imprisoned in the Second World War for his faith, he said, as he wrote from prison, "A prison cell in which one waits and hopes and is completely dependent on the fact that the door to freedom has to be opened from the outside is not a bad picture of Advent." And he described his time waiting, waiting in prison, waiting for freedom. And as we look at scripture, we see so much waiting in the Christmas story, don't we? Waiting seems to be a theme in the Christmas story. Mary, who commentators put at the age between 13 and 18, 14 and 18, we're talking about a teenager. Mary undergoes a significant time of waiting. The scripture in Luke chapter 1 says, that the angel appeared to her suddenly and said, "Greetings to you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." And Mary was greatly troubled at these words. You can imagine an angel suddenly breaking into your everyday with amazing news. And she wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid. Mary, you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus." How I still could never imagine what that was like for Mary, this extraordinary moment of an angel breaking into her every day. But imagine the waiting ahead for her. She had to wait to see if she would become pregnant indeed, if she would indeed bear the baby. Imagine the months of pregnancy and waiting and wondering, the speculation about her state, the speculation about Joseph and the state of their betrothal. So much waiting for her, so much wrestling for her. Another person caught up, of course, in the waiting is Joseph, isn't it? We see Joseph is an honorable man. Joseph and Mary were betrothed, they were engaged, but it was much more binding than we see engagement today. It was almost like a marriage. It was the pre-stage to marriage. And he decided to separate from Mary honorably when he discovered she was pregnant. But Matthew 1, verses 19 to 21 tell us, because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he'd considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." And so we see Joseph then had to wrestle with what the angel told him. And he too was exposed to waiting. He has to wrestle with watching his wife's pregnancy, waiting for this miraculously conceived baby to be born, waiting to consummate his marriage, waiting to see how it looked to be an earthly father to a Messiah. A lot of waiting. Elizabeth Elliot, who was a missionary to the Orca Indians in Ecuador, you might know her. Her husband Jim Elliot was one of the five who were slain by the Orca Indians as they went to take the gospel. And she knew a lot about waiting as she brought their daughter Valerie up on the mission field as a widow. She said, "Waiting on God requires the willingness to bear uncertainty, to carry within oneself an unanswered question, lifting the heart to God about it whenever it intrudes upon one's thoughts." Waiting and living with uncertainty. Does that resonate with you? Any of you living with uncertainty? With waiting for something? With longing for God to move in a situation and not seeing it happen? With having faith that you believe God can do something, but having to wait to see what the answer is? I can see lots of nods. I think it's something that resonates with us all, isn't it? This question of waiting and living with uncertainty. I'm fortunate enough to have some people in my life who really are like Mary, who can wait with grace and patience, and elegance, unlike me, who can wait and listen to God and respond well. I have people close to me in my life who are like that, and I'm so grateful for them. But me, I find myself constantly wrestling. I've got such a rich history with God. I've got so many points where I could tell you I've seen him working, seen him moving, seen him doing miraculous things like in Albania in 1991, seen him move in incredible ways. And yet somehow I still often find myself wrestling. And so the third person in the Christmas narrative who receives a visit from an angel, but who also has to embark on a period of waiting, is one that seems to resonate with my heart a great deal. And that is Zechariah. Who is Zechariah? Zechariah is a high priest. He's from a priestly lineage in the line of Aaron. And we meet him. He's married to Elizabeth. They go on to Father John the Baptist. So he's a very significant person in Scripture. But we meet him as he's going about the course of his duties. And in the course of his duties as a priest, part of his job was to be the voice of God to the people, and then to listen to the people and be the voice of the people to God. So Zechariah had a very important role. And once or maybe twice in their life, such a priest would get to offer incense at the altar. It was a very significant day, a very holy day when they got to burn incense. And we meet Zechariah on this special day, this day when he's burning incense at the altar. This is the high point. If you think of your career, this is the high point of his career. He's doing the thing he was created to do. He is fulfilling his high priestly function, burning this incense and making an offering of worship to God. And we meet him in Luke 1:13 as an angel appears to him. And Zechariah and Elizabeth, they're old. They have a similar story to Sarah and Abraham in the Old Testament. They've longed for children. They don't have children. They're way past their childbearing years. And we meet Zechariah as he is in the temple offering this incense. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him standing at the right side of the altar of incense. If ever there was a time you might expect God to speak to you, it would be at this moment. And he does it. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord." And so we have this extraordinary moment. You've longed for a child. You've been faithful serving as a priest. You and your wife Elizabeth are blameless and upright in the sight of the Lord, it says elsewhere. And you're at the altar of incense at the high point of your career, offering incense to God, and an angel appears. Boom! God has answered your prayer. What is your response? Very human. Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I am an old man and my wife is well along in years." Human doubt creeping in at the crucial moment. If this was a drama and we were watching it enacted, this is a point of high drama. And Zechariah, the humanness of his doubt at this point. How's this going to happen? I'm old, my wife is old. Friends, you know the rest of the story, don't you? What happens? We read it in Luke 1:19. The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you to tell you good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." And so Zechariah, what happens to him? He's unable to speak. Throughout the whole of Elizabeth's pregnancy, he's unable to speak. I heard a youth pastor preaching on this, and he said, "Can you imagine the miracle of striking someone unable to speak? I wish I had that power." Truly extraordinary. And Zechariah, so he is embarking on this enforced period of waiting. So we see Mary, we see Joseph, we see Zechariah. All of these crucial characters in this story that is so important to us, that tells us about Jesus' birth. And here we see waiting at the core of all they have to do. Henry Nouwen captures the spiritual issues in waiting beautifully. He says, "Waiting time is not wasting time. Waiting patiently in expectation is the foundation of spiritual life." Waiting patiently. Waiting time is not wasting time. How do you feel? Are some of you really wrestling with waiting for something? And this encourages us, doesn't it, that the waiting is part of it. This is part of our faith journey. And God is not absent in the waiting. So one of the questions that was on my mind as I looked at these scriptures was, what does it take to wait well? Our girls often fill the house with their friends, and a number of them are thinking, what happens in the future? What happens when I finish my degree? What job should I apply for? Should I do further study? These questions of planning and dreaming and thinking, they're so real for us, aren't they? And at different stages of our lives can be more real at different times. And so what does it take to wait well? Well, we get some clues from Mary. Her beautiful response to the angel is the song we know as the Magnificat in Luke 1:46. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for the Lord has looked with favor on the lowliness of the Almighty's servant. That is her response to the angel's message that she will bear Jesus. Read her song sometime. It is so beautiful. It is beautiful and it is powerful. Interestingly, Lloyd and I have been doing some reading about Mary because she's such a fascinating character. This song of hers was actually banned in Guatemala as too political. Also in the Indian British Empire in India, the last years of the British Empire, it was banned because she said the Lord will bring down the mighty and he will exalt the lowly. And that's a picture of God's kingdom, isn't it? That the last shall be first, that the least shall be served and saved. And this is what Mary understands in her soul about who Jesus is. And so from her, we see this beautiful song of praise. Her calling's not easy, is it? That journey to Bethlehem at 9 months pregnant, I don't think any of us envy that. Giving birth in an animal stable, don't think many of us envy that. And then having to flee with your infant because Herod is persecuting and killing all the baby boys and becoming a refugee in another nation. She does not have an easy calling. But we see that she worships God, she praises God, and she listens when God speaks. That's surely a challenge for me. A little later in Mary's story, we see in Luke chapter 2, but Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. She takes time to reflect. She takes time to think. Do you have time for those things? And then Joseph. Joseph responds in a different way, doesn't he? We know his initial response to the pregnancy, to Mary's divine pregnancy, is I'll divorce her quietly and just separate myself from this story. We read the vision he has where an angel appears to him and speaks to him. But then we have this breathtaking verse about Joseph. Luke chapter 1, verse 24. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord commanded him. He was obedient. And he took Mary home as his wife, but he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son. And he gave him the name Jesus. It's really interesting. In Scripture, we don't hear Joseph's voice. I searched. We don't hear Joseph speak. But what do we see of Joseph's life? We see obedient action, don't we? We see a man who had a message from God, a really hard calling. Take this pregnant woman to be your wife. Live with the innuendo, the gossip, the slurs, the murmurings. Live with all that this will mean in bewilderment and be faithful. And what does he do? He's faithful. Joseph shows us that in the waiting, we can be faithful with obedient action. And some of us, that's the way we show our service, isn't it? By faithful, obedient action. And then there's Zechariah. Zechariah. What does he do in the waiting? Actually, Scripture doesn't tell us. We don't know what went through his heart and mind. Those 9 months must have been really long, unable to speak. For someone like me, I would probably have expired. I've been unable to speak for 9 months. And then I was talking about this with a friend the other day, this waiting period for Zechariah. And they said, it must have been even longer, those 8 days after the baby was born, when you might imagine you were able to speak, but he had to wait till the baby was circumcised to give the baby a name. Can you imagine those extra 8 days of waiting between the birth and the circumcision, thinking, God, is this going on forever? Am I just going to be silent? So he had a lot of wrestling and pondering. But we get a clue to how Zechariah waited. We get a clue that he didn't wait with bitterness, that he didn't rage against God in his inner person. We get a clue that even if he did, he came through in an amazing way. Because in Luke chapter 1, 22, we see this extraordinary circumstance. When Zechariah came out of the temple, he could not speak. And yet, we see it. The baby's circumcision, who we know as John the Baptist, there is this question, what will the baby be called? And everyone in the community assumes the baby will be called Zechariah, because that's what you do in your family naming. You name the boy for his father, of course. And Zechariah has a choice at that moment. And at that moment, it says in Luke 1:61 that he gestures for a writing pad and writes, no, he is to be called John. It's an act of obedience. He still can't speak. He has to write it. And it causes great puzzlement. There's no one among your relatives who has that name. And yet Zechariah makes it so clear that he's been deliberately obedient to what God has said this time round. And he says he is to be called John. And then the result of that obedience, the result of that action of faith, Luke 1:63. Immediately his mouth opened and his tongue was set free and he began to speak, praising God. The immediate result of Zechariah's faith journey, whatever goes on in that 9 months and 8 days that he has to wait, whatever wrestlings he's having with God, it results in obedient action. No, he's to be called John. And then this glorious song of praise. And do read Zechariah's song. It's a beautiful song of praise. And what we see, of course, is that these three stories are a glorious contrast to one another, aren't they? It means we don't all wait in the same way as we're waiting on God. And that's okay. We don't all have to wait in the same way. We have Mary, such beautiful instant obedience and faith, such trust, that beautiful song of praise that comes from her heart as she worships God when he gives her the message about the Messiah. And you see, we get a glimpse in that, don't we, of why God chose her to bear Jesus. We get a glimpse of that in that beautiful response. And then for Joseph. Joseph has dealt a difficult hand in this story, is he not? This is not an easy path for him either. And yet we see in him that quiet, obedient action, that he follows through on what God's asked him to do and he does it. And sometimes actions speak louder than words, don't they? And then for the Zechariahs amongst us, those of us who wrestle, those of us for whom maybe first-time obedience isn't our instant response to God, who wrestle and question, he encourages us, doesn't he? He encourages us that God is always the God of the second chance. That if we wrestle and fail, if this Christmas we get it wrong, if things are difficult and we haven't lived what we know God called us to live in obedience and in worship, there's a second chance that Jesus always offers us, restoration and redemption. He offers us the chance to come to him, to restore us and allow us another opportunity. And Zechariah encourages those of us who are wrestling that there is always that second chance. So friends, as we wrap up these Christmas narratives we've been looking at, and we look at these three characters who had to wait and their relationship with God and what it shows us, we see God uses ordinary people like us, all kinds of people, in his big overarching story of redemption. And that means each one of us here, he uses us as we make ourselves available. We see that we can doubt and wrestle and misunderstand, but God always offers restoration and redemption, a second chance as we come back to him. And we see that the outworking of our faith is obedience, is praise, is worship, offered in words and song and action. We have Mary with that glorious song of praise, Joseph with his quiet, obedient action, and Zechariah offering us learning and wrestling, but prophecy and worship and obedience. So how are you doing in the waiting this Advent? How's your faith? We're into the crazy season, aren't we? It's busy. We're tired. Some people are limping towards the end of the year. But let's remember these three people and let's remember their journeys and let them encourage us as we keep walking forward with Jesus at this time of year. Stephen Furtick says, the only thing harder than waiting on God is wishing that you had. The only thing harder than waiting on God is wishing that you had. We've got the opportunity to wait on God, to listen to God, no matter where we are in this journey of faith, to wrestle, to learn, to be honest with him, and always look up and offer our lives in praise, obedience, worship, action, and glorify him in all that we're doing. May there be joy in the waiting, friends. May there be grace in the wrestling. And may we all celebrate Jesus well as we approach Christmas. Let's pray. Father God, thank you that you see each one of us. You know us so well. You know what's going on in our inner hearts. Wherever we are, Lord, in our journey of faith, encourage us, hold us close, give us strength, refill us with your Holy Spirit. Lift our eyes up to see you. Lift our hearts in worship and prayer. And Lord, help us to hold on. Help us to keep walking forward. And may we share about you with many others this Christmas, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, we're now going to just think about those things as we turn to communion, to our celebration. In a week's time, we're going to be thinking about Jesus' birth. And then as we take communion, we think about his death and his resurrection. Rachel Held Evans, she said, "This is what God's kingdom is like. A bunch of outcasts and oddballs gathered at a table. Not because they're rich or worthy or good, but because they're hungry and they said yes." And that's what we're doing today as we take communion, isn't it, friends? We're saying yes. We're saying yes. We love you, Lord. Yes, we may have messed up and got it wrong, but we know you love us and we know you redeem us and restore us. And this Christmas, we come to communion not because we must, but because we may. The bread symbolizes the body of Christ broken for us, the blood, his cup freely shed for us. And in a moment, we will eat and drink together because we may, in celebration of all Christ has done. So let's pray, shall we? We come to this table in faith, Lord Jesus. We're often weak, but you are strong. We struggle, but you encourage us. And in this season, we thank you for your choice to come and live with us here on earth. In this act of communion, we celebrate your death and resurrection, your gift of forgiveness and new life. Like Mary, we praise you with our lips. Like Joseph, we honor you with obedient lives. And like Zechariah, we offer you our worship. So be with us now as we eat and drink. In your name, amen. So let's go and, friends, take the symbols of faith and eat and drink together. And so, friends, let's eat and drink together with joy, gratitude, and thanksgiving for all Jesus has done for us. And so, Lord Jesus, we think of Mary's words. I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said. Lord, we're your servants. We offer our lives to you and we thank you for each other. In Jesus' name. Amen.